Welcome to The Inclusion Show, the show that includes you, where different points of view and perspectives are presented for your consideration. Most importantly, while inclusion doesn't offer opinions, concepts, and ideas, we try to make sure that they're fact-based. Unlike other shows, inclusion really is a reality show. Now on tonight's show, we have Point of View, a contemporary commentary taken straight from the Point of View blog. We'll also have Time for a Conversation, a conversation on a current topic with a special guest. Tonight's guest is Miss Ilyasah Shabazz, who, in addition to being the daughter of the legendary leader Malcolm X and the noted educator Dr. Betty Shabazz, has a lot to say about her own current projects and what she's doing in this world today. And finally, the Inclusion Show will close with From the Heart, a totally unscripted and unedited expression on a current topic presented to you spontaneously and unedited. And now, you're invited to think, watch, and listen to inclusion, and make up your own mind. After all, you are included. Obama's back. The best thing about the most recent presidential debate is that the Barack Obama, who inspired a nation and electrified the world, actually showed up. Now, Mitt Romney returned with more salvos of bluster and sketchy math, and he has shown a remarkable ability to lie with confidence, which is an indispensable talent for a confidence man. Now, when questioned about his unwavering support for the National Rifle Association's positions on gun control, which is namely as little gun control as possible, he actually said that he didn't see a need for more legislation or regulation, even in the instance of assault rifles like AK-47s. And then he went off on some illogical riff about how single-parent families are some significant causal factor when it comes to random gun violence. And you go figure. Unlike the first debate, however, President Obama did not let Mitt Romney simply cakewalk his way through his tax cut song and dance. Ultimately, Mr. Romney's message to the American people is that the math is his and that in his budget plan it'll work because he said so. In running for the nomination of the Republican Party, now Mr. Romney has pitched so far to the right that now he's trying to walk back from some of his draconian positions on issues like contraception and abortion. He did maintain his draconian position, however, on immigration, and we will have to see how that plays out with American voters who are immigrants themselves or the children of immigrants, the grandchildren of immigrants. But President Obama saved his best for last, nailing Mitt Romney on his infamous 47% soliloquy. When Mr. Romney, in his final comments, included his tinny love song to the 100% of Americans, Barack Obama reminded everyone of what Mitt Romney said behind closed doors. Now, the best thing about this second presidential debate is that style was no longer the issue. The issues were the issue. And both candidates were combative, they were aggressive, and assertive. And each candidate provided a very clear choice to the American people, even when Mitt Romney tried to cloud matters by watering down some fire and brimstone that he had already served up to get the nomination from the Republican Party in the first place. Every day, step by step, the choice is getting clearer and clearer. And now it's time for a conversation. Our special guest this evening is Miss Ilyasah Shabazz. Ilyasah is the daughter of the iconic leader Malcolm X, as her mother was the noted educator Dr. Betty Shabazz, who I had the good fortune of knowing as well. And Ilyasah, welcome to the Inclusion Show. Okay, yes, I said fine. Okay. And on that happy note, we're here tonight to Ilyasah, talk a little bit about you and what you're doing these days, and of course your thoughts on just what's happening in the world, particularly of course the presidential election being less than 3 weeks away. But for starters, and I think certainly our viewers would like to know, and children of very famous and prominent people sometimes have different life experiences, and if you wouldn't mind sharing with us just a little bit, being the child of just two incredible and prominent people, how you might say your life has been different or the same for that matter?
I think that Some people would say that my life is different. Some people would say that my life is the same, and that we've had similar experiences. The difference is, I think, having Malcolm and Betty as parents and them making sure that their children were raised proud to be African Americans, proud to be of the African diaspora, proud to be women, proud to be Muslims. Growing up, there were a lot of expectations, and so it was very challenging. It was very, very difficult sure. Once I went to college. Before mm-hmm. college, it was fabulous, uh-huh. you know?
And where were you in college?
I was upstate New York.
Okay.
And there were
any hints?
And there were a lot of people who would chase me, you know, on campus. You're Malcolm X's daughter. You're Malcolm X's daughter. Uh-huh. I know you were Malcolm X's daughter, and it was overwhelming. Uh-huh. And you know, I didn't know who I was supposed to be because they had specific expectations,
and preconceived notions, really.
Absolutely. Huh? Yeah. You know that I was there, and that I had experienced the same lifestyle that my father experienced, mm-hmm. and they expected me to be very aggressive and outgoing, and you know, depending on who they thought Malcolm was, is what sure. they expected of me. And so it was a little difficult trying to live up to other people's expectations. And so I think once I understood that I didn't have to live up to other people's expectations, that as long as I had this relationship with God, that you know, uh-huh. you know, that I was, you know, look at this woman in the mirror and be comfortable with that I was okay.
Well, now, of course, you're all grown up, and you know, you've had a very interesting career, just from what I know. But exactly, what are you doing these days that you can share with us?
Well, I think what has been very consistent in my life is my commitment to empowering young people, to self-actualization. That stressing the importance of history. And
now, if you don't, pardon me, what does self-actualization mean? What is that?
Well, I think it's important to have an identity. You know, okay. a lot of young people think that history isn't important, that their identity isn't important.
Certainly.
That the most important thing is to be able to make money. You know, that it's mm-hmm. all about me, 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 me. And they don't understand the notion of compassion for others, that we are, since the beginning of time, here to live purpose-driven lives. I mean, with uh-huh. compassion for others, that we are our brothers and sisters keeper. The notion of that African proverb, that it really does take a village to raise a child. Mm-hmm. The importance, you know, of our contribution. But I think when we understand the importance of history, we understand that we can't sit back and expect someone else to do something for us.
So, you know? So when you're speaking to young people, and just what ages are we talking about when you are speaking to children? Little kids, teenagers, or
of the above? It's all of the above. I put together the Wake Up Tour, and so we go to either college campuses, to convention centers. We've spoken to teachers. You know, uh-huh. we've gone to teacher conventions. Just the importance of understanding people of color, understanding not only people of color, but the history. You know.
Well, it's interesting that you mentioned that, yeah. Ilyasah, because of course, over the last 20, 25 years, we've seen, you know, in many ways, you know, kind of, I think it's fair to say, a cultural decline in communities of color, and in black communities in particular. Just the way that men and women refer to themselves in cultural expression, in movies and videos and music and what have you. The way, you know, the so-called N-word is now part of people just see that as part of the language at this point. How do you try to counteract that?
You know, it's really all about respect. You know, self-respect. Mm-hmm. You know, again, understanding who you are, understanding your heritage. My father often talked about the parallel oppression of contemporary Jews to people of African descent, people of color. Mm-hmm. And he said that Jewish people never lost pride in being Jewish. They knew they made a significant contribution to society, to world history, and they vow to teach their children at a young age who they are and of that journey. Mm-hmm. And
that's a very good point. You don't see in the Jewish community anyone using the K word.
Right. They
for example, I've never heard of it.
Right.
Never heard of it.
Right. And then even when you go back to that, the case study where the young children were given the dolls, the black and white dolls, and
right.
they were identical, but they had, you know, they believed that the black doll was dirty, ugly,
right.
mean,
right.
dumb,
this
and the
Dr.
white doll.
Kenneth Clark study, yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. And the white doll was happy, smart, and all these great
sure.
things. That has to take an effect on one.
Mm-hmm.
You know. So I just think it's extremely important to understand the contributions, the sacrifice, the psychological trauma endured by these people, you know, who endured a lifetime of enslavement, that they were human beings who had mm-hmm. feelings, that they were culturally diverse, technically advanced, and in order to contribute so much. So, you know, I just think it's very important that we understand history, and this is a part of it. You know, whether we're talking about Africa, whether we're talking about Jewish people, whatever it is, mm-hmm. but that when we understand the contribution, you know, the foundation of this country, and so many other things, that it usually is, you know, the image and perception of Africa is inaccurate.
Well, speaking of that, as I said, some inside knowledge we have here. I know that recently you were in Africa and a visit to West Africa. How was I'm taking that was not your first visit to the African continent, but how was your experience in visiting Africa in the Nigeria in 2012? I mean, what was your experience there? Your impressions?
Well, you know, it's just like it is. Well, I should say the people are very much like we are.
Okay.
And you know, I took so many pictures, and oftentimes when I show the pictures, the people, you know, to African Americans or just American people or wherever it is,
mm-hmm.
for people who haven't traveled much, mm-hmm. they're really dumbfounded. And because, you know, their hair salons, the girls are getting weaves. You know, they're braiding their hair, they're doing the same thing that,
uh-huh.
you know, we do over here. You know, we think that when people are fairer complexion, it's because their great-great-grandmother was Irish or something.
Mm-hmm.
And it's different tribes. You know, it's just, I love being there because I think, particularly in Nigeria, they are known for their intellectual
agility.
Yes.
Ah, there.
You know, they're very business oriented.
Yes.
They're very astute, very educated.
Mm-hmm.
You know, very much involved in being very progressive.
Well, Nigeria has the highest literacy rate on the African continent,
right.
certainly, and in
right.
many universities. And well, how were you received there? I mean, when you went?
Well, you know, I'm almost embarrassed, but I planned to be there for 6 days, and I ended up staying for a month.
Wow.
And I spent my birthday there. They gave me this big, you know, so many, I don't want to really call them parties, but, you know, so many celebrations.
There you go.
You know, one for my birthday, yeah. one for the women gave me something, the historical, cultural, you know, organizations mm-hmm. gave through these events. And you never have to worry about not having a party, you know, well attended, because they're what is the largest population of African people in the world.
Right, right,
yeah.
sure. Well, that's I'm sure you'll be going back.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, I'm sure. Well,
and actually, we're going to be doing an African Heritage Festival.
Is that right?
Yeah.
And we being.
Well, I have Ilyasah Shabazz Enterprises,
okay.
Malcolm X Enterprises,
mm-hmm.
and the Kingsley and Bodyway Foundation over there.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Excellent. And just for viewers, the website to follow up on what Ilyasah is doing is certainly going to be on the screen as well. So hopefully people will follow up directly with you. In the time we have left, Ilyasah, I can't let you go without, we always ask about this because it's just important. November 6th is not too far away. is a very important presidential election. They're all important, but this one seems to be a little bit more important because of the very different views that that President Obama and Governor Romney are bringing to the table here and presenting to the American people. What do you think about it? What's your views on what's going on with this, with the campaign? What's your views? I'm not asking who you're going to vote for, but I know you're going to vote, you know. But what do you think about what's going on? What do you see as the key concerns or issues that our viewers ought to be thinking about before they walk into that voting booth on November 6th?
Well, you know, I think that oftentimes we complain about what our leaders aren't doing for us. And I think it's important to understand that we are those leaders that we seek, and that we have to do our job. We have to make sure that we understand that we have the power to put this gentleman in office, and that we have to do our parts. I mean, you can only imagine who I'm voting for. We're having the final debate, a presidential debate watch party next Monday.
Right.
In Harlem at Social Corner.
Okay.
That we will...
Lenox Avenue on 126th Street for those
right.
in the New York area.
Malcolm
yes.
X Boulevard. Yeah.
What's wrong with me? Right, yes.
Right. Right. But I just think it's very important that we understand our role.
Mm-hmm.
And that if we want President Obama to do things for us, that we have to make sure that we put him in office and that we have an agenda of our own.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, that's very good. Well, you know, Ilyasah Shabazz, it's been a while since we've had the opportunity to see you. I want to thank you so much for coming on the show this evening. And that's all right. It's a secret handshake. You know, we wish you all the best in your various ventures, you and your family. And hope that you'll accept our invitation to come back to the show. Whenever you have an open invitation, I think
okay.
the producer will agree with that anytime you want to come back, it's fine with us. So
terrific.
Thank you so much again. Okay. And stay strong. And now it's time for From the Heart. Tonight's topic, the Obama-Romney gender gap is shrinking. My question is, what are these women thinking? Now, I've got a message certainly for women out there who are planning to vote on November 6th. Before you go into that voting booth, think about Mitt Romney's positions on a few issues like Planned Parenthood, plans to defund it, contraception, plans to limit women's access to contraception, abortion restrictions, plans to limit abortion only in the instance of rape and incest, okay? And of course, as his colleague Paul Ryan has talked about, forcible rape and ultimately no access to abortion services at all. Limited health care coverage for women's health issues that's currently provided in the Affordable Care Act, also known as Obamacare. And no support for the Ledbetter Equal Pay Act, which of course tries to right the terrible wrong that women in the workplace these days make 73% of what their male counterparts make. Now, but again, a message to the women who are out there who are somehow contributing to this gender gap growing smaller and smaller between Mitt Romney and President Barack Obama. Just keep in mind those items there, because that's your life, that's your future, that's the future of your children that we're speaking about. Now, I hope you enjoyed Inclusion. Keep your texts and tweets and emails coming in, and we'll look forward to seeing you for the next episode. Please share the link for this show, and if you're on Facebook, don't forget to like Inclusion. You can also follow the Inclusion Show on Twitter at Wallace Ford, and you can read the point of view commentaries at the blog address shown on the screen. And remember, Inclusion is the only show that includes you. Thank you.